darkest place, life, even in the pain, it feels like coming home.
Where the Spirit is,
where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. I am free, amen. Where the Spirit
Hello and welcome. The Lord be with you. Welcome to our online Anglican prayer book service for Warragul Anglican Church. It's great to have you with us, and we hope that this service is going to be a blessing for you. These services are pre-recorded, and we add to them our weekly Bible reading, our weekly sermon, and our hymns. So as we progress through the service, you might see some video shots from a different location, because they were recorded at a slightly different time. Just a heads up for that. Later in the service, we'll have communion, and I'll invite you at that time to say a prayer of spiritual communion to join with me in that moment of communion. You might also like, if you wish, to pause the video and have some bread and some juice ready for that moment. Well, our church service today is being held on traditional lands of the Gunai Kurnai people. They are the traditional owners of the land, and as we start, I'd like to pay my respects to their elders, past and present. And as we start, let's encourage each other with this verse from Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 and following says this: "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. Isn't life more than food? And the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they?" Rhetorical question. The answer, of course, is yes. You are of more value than they. It is easy to worry. So let's commence our service with this prayer. Lord God, as we spend time with you now, draw us into freedom from worry that this verse encourages. Help us to hear your voice and to see you at work in our lives and the lives of those in the world around us. Thank you for your care of our world. Because of you, we're able to take each day as it comes without fretting, to celebrate each moment that you give us, confident that you will not fail us. Let's continue in prayer, our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, we remind ourselves of what we are called to as God's people in this world through these words of Scripture. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. Jesus said, "This is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbour as yourself." Lord, have mercy on us and write your law on our hearts by your Holy Spirit. Friends, I invite you to join with me now in reciting together the Nicene Creed of our church mothers and fathers. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven and was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary. He became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and on the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, and who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church, and we acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Friends, we're now going to have our Bible readings for the week after our first hymn and then our sermon. Our Bible readings today are from the book of Acts and also from the letter to John. But before I read those readings, let me lead us in a prayer for our day today, a prayer of the day on Anzac Day, this fourth Sunday in Easter. So let's pray. O God, our ruler and guide, in whose hands are the destinies of this and every nation, we give you thanks for the freedoms we enjoy in this land and for those who laid down their lives to defend them. We pray that we and all the people of Australia, gratefully remembering their courage and their sacrifice, may have grace to live in a spirit of justice, of generosity, and of peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. So our first reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 5 to 12, and it's a reading of where Peter and John are brought before some leaders following the healing of a man. So Acts 4, verses 5 to 12. The next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them, "By what power or what name did you do this?" And then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we're being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead. That is the reason that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." Hear the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading is from the book of 1 John, chapter 3, verses 16 to 24. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us love, not with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. This is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence. If our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts and he knows everything. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask because we keep his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. The one who keeps God's commands lives in him, and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. Hear the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
God our Father, creator of all things, true source of light and wisdom, be gracious to us. Let a ray of your light penetrate the darkness of our understanding. Give us confidence in the power of your gospel. Grant us clarity in understanding and proclaiming the truths of your word. Amen. Good morning. Welcome to our sermon this morning, which I've entitled Windows to the Soul. How many times have you been to a funeral, listened to the eulogy or eulogies, and then you think, or you say to yourself, good grief, I never really knew this person properly. This is often not just a friend or an acquaintance, it sometimes could be a relative or a close friend. And even though nice things are almost always said about the deceased at funerals, even when you separate the exaggerated from the real, you find yourself saying, that's not the person that I knew. And at times I've had to admit, I felt a little bit ashamed that I never scratched through the surface and got to know these people properly in their lives. As an example, I had a sister-in-law who died very prematurely after a prolonged illness. We weren't very close. We weren't very close, actually, geographically. They lived in the far north of Melbourne. We lived in the far south. And in a relationship sense, we weren't all that close. But our families did get together every Christmas and every anniversary and so on. And we used to have a pleasant enough time together. But I was amazed that at her funeral, one of her daughters spoke of how her mother was such a big fan of football. A big fan of football. In fact, she spoke about the time that they drove across to Adelaide to watch a significant match over there. I have to say, we had never, in all our many years of association, we'd never ever spoke about football. And I found myself saying, almost with a little shame, that I never really got to know Carol in her 50-odd years here on earth. I had a similar experience recently when I read a book that revealed to me for the first time the whole life of the great artist Vincent van Gogh. There's probably roughly three things that you and I would know about van Gogh, and I bet they're the same things. One, he only sold one painting in his lifetime. Two, he cut off his ear. And three, he committed suicide. The book, which was entitled Windows of the Soul, was written by Ken Geyer. And he began with a quote from the Russian writer Alexander Solzhenitsyn, whose novel so upset the Russians that they sent him into the labor camps. And Solzhenitsyn said, art can warm even a chilled and sunless soul to an exalted spiritual experience. Through art, we occasionally receive, indistinctly, briefly, revelations the likes of which cannot be achieved by rational thought. It is like the small mirror of legend. You look into it, but instead of yourself, you glimpse for a moment the inaccessible, a realm forever beyond reach, and your soul begins to ache. C.S. Lewis explained that the right way to look at a work of art was, we sit down before a picture in order to have something done to us, not that we may do things with it. The first demand any work of art makes upon us is surrender. Look, listen, receive. For many of us, though, that's not what we do. We look and listen, but instead of receiving, we react. Instead of surrendering, we resist. Instead of coming away changed, we come away critical. And that is true whether we come away from a piece of art, from a movie on a Saturday night, or a sermon that we might hear on Sunday morning. Gaia tells of a prominent Catholic priest who was deeply moved by one of Rembrandt's work of art, the painting The Return of the Prodigal Son. And after sitting in front of the painting for 4 hours, he stated, the painting has become a mysterious window through which I can step into the kingdom of God. Gaia then contrasts his own reaction for the first time when he saw the art of Van Gogh and his painting Irises. And it was in the Getty Museum in California. He said, I stood, not sat, before it, and at a distance. I looked not for 4 hours, not even for 4 minutes. A minute maybe, and that's all. My reaction was disbelief. How could such an ordinary painting, he said, sell for millions, irises of all things? He said, I shook my head and I walked away and I forgot Van Gogh until many years later. Guy had read that Van Gogh believed in God at one period of his life. He did it passionately, and then he remembered the words of the song Vincent by Don McLean, recorded as a tribute to Van Gogh. And this time he listened more intently. Some of the words were, "Now I understand what you tried to say to me and how you suffered for your sanity and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen. They did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now." Guy wondered, was he one of those not listening? What was Vincent trying to say? And so he decided to read all the books he could find on Van Gogh. And this is what he found. Van Gogh started life as the son of a pastor. And from the beginning, he wanted to sow the words of the Bible to the poor and working class people. He spent endless nights copying page after page of the Bible, translating it into English, German and French. "I read it daily," he wrote, "but I should like to know it by heart and to view life in the light of its words." He went to London and he preached to the poor in the most dangerous, dirty parts of a city. He sought a theological education, but his zeal and his eccentricities won him no friends in the religious establishment. And so to get him out of the way, he was assigned as a lay evangelist to an impoverished coal mining town. There he plunged into his work, living amongst the miners and sharing their poverty. He went down the mines to be with them, breathing into his lungs the same black dust. And he preached to them on Sundays, trying his best to infuse a little light, a little hope into their cold, black lives. He wrote to his brother, "I should be very happy if someday I could draw them so that those unknown or little known types would be brought before the eyes of the people." And so that's what he did. He drew them. But the more he drew them, the less he preached, until one day he only drew. I should add, he though continued himself as a Christian. Because of his extreme self-denial and his fanatical zeal, the church terminated his position. And at 27, he embarks on what was to become his journey as an artist. He is, though, still naturally drawn to the poor and the downtrodden, and they dominate his paintings. In his letters, he said, "I want to say something comforting. I want to paint men and women with that something of the eternal which the halo used to symbolize." And he painted pictures of a peasant woman sewing, of farm labourers, men and women in the fields or in their homes, exhausted at the end of the day, having their evening meal, a woman weeping, two women praying, a woman with a child in her lap. Van Gogh's sketch, entitled Sitting at Eternity's Gate, is of a man sitting in a chair, his face buried in his hands. In this print, he said, I've tried to express what seems to me one of the strongest proofs of the existence of God and eternity. Certainly, in the infinitely touching expression of such a little old man, which he himself is perhaps unconscious of when he's sitting in his chair in the corner by the fire. And at the same time, there's something precious, something noble, which cannot be destined for worms. But no one seemed to understand what this impassioned artist was trying to say. It was as if it was a foreign language that he was using. Through years of rejection, loneliness, and depression, Vincent's mental state deteriorated, as did, unfortunately, his spiritual life. Mention of his faith gradually disappears from his letters. In 1889, he was admitted to an asylum in France, and from his sparsely furnished room, he had a view of the countryside with its sun-washed fields and also the back garden, where there was a plot of flowers, mostly irises, and he painted those irises. A painting which he claimed restored his sanity. That's the same painting which Ken Guy stood in front of over 100 years later and shook his head and walked away from. His sanity, though, only returned for a time. And in that same year, he painted Starry Night, the one sung of in Don McLean's song. In it, you can see something of the dark night of Vincent's soul. But then, when he looked up, there he saw the stars and the starlight too. I've got a copy of that painting. I'll hold it up for you to have a look at. That wasn't, of course, the original I was showing you there. In fact, that one we bought from a house clearance sale for $5. But you could see there something of the dark night of Vincent's soul. He wrote of this painting, "For my part, I know nothing with any certainty, but the sight of the stars makes me dream." His final painting, completed in 1890, is titled simply Cornfield with Crows. Of this, he wrote, "It's a vast field of wheat under troubled skies, and I did not need to go out of my way to express sadness and extreme loneliness." And not long afterwards, he went out into those vast fields and he shot himself. He wasn't even a good shot, and he missed his heart, so he lingered long enough for his brother to get to his side, where he spoke his last words, "La tristesse durera," which means the sadness will never go away. Someone said that you are a success if at the end of your life, the people who knew you best are the ones who respect you the most. Vincent's mother and brother knew that he had a great heart for the poor and the downtrodden. And his mother had said, "This will surely not go unobserved by God." Ken Guy was ashamed that Van Gogh's life had been unobserved by him and his work so casually dismissed, and that now he saw something else. He saw through Vincent something of the great artist of souls, Jesus. "Christ," said Van Gogh, "is more of an artist than the artists. He works in the living spirit and the living flesh. He makes men instead of statues. Like Vincent, Jesus drew our attention to the sower in the field, the birds of the air, the flowers of the fields, and the faces of the poor. Like Vincent, Christ has, to borrow Don McLean's words, eyes that know the darkness in my soul, hands like a narcissus that soothes weathered faces lined in pain. And like Vincent, he tried to set them free. But unlike Vincent, who died from a self-inflicted wound, Jesus was killed by others. Unlike Vincent, whose last days were filled with despair, Jesus, even on the night he was betrayed, encouraged his disciples. And whilst on the cross, he encouraged the thief next to him. And even when forsaken, Jesus entrusted his spirit to his Father's hands. There were some similarities, but much separates the two artists. Yet, in their deaths, they have this in common. Jesus, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and Vincent with his last words, "The sadness will never go away." Don McLean's words, "And how you tried to set them free, they would not listen. They're not listening still. Perhaps they never will," reflects something of both Christ's and Vincent's sorrow. Passers-by stood at a distance and criticized both artists. They shook their heads and they walked away. "Look at the pictures," is what they were both saying. "And if you look with the right eyes, those pictures will become windows leading out of the darkness so that we can find our way home. A home that we will share with our Lord Jesus Christ, set free by his life given on the cross for each one of us." And a closing prayer. May God's word be in your heart. May God's word be on your lips. May God's word be in your touch. May God's word direct your feet on this day and all your days to come. May God's word be the life you live. Amen.
Friends, let's have a quiet moment of prayer where we might be able to listen to what God has said to us through the readings and through the sermon this week. And then I'll continue to lead us in some community prayers. Let's continue in prayer for all people and for the church throughout the world. Almighty and ever-living God, we are taught by your holy apostle to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people. We ask you in your mercy to receive our prayers which we offer to your divine majesty. We pray that you will lead the nations of the world in the ways of righteousness and peace, and that you'll guide their rulers in wisdom and justice for the tranquility and good of all. Bless especially your servant Elizabeth, our Queen, her representatives and ministers, her parliaments, and all who exercise authority in this land. Grant that they may impartially administer justice, restrain wickedness and vice, and uphold integrity and truth. We beseech you to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, Heavenly Father, to all bishops and ministers, including myself, that by our life and doctrine we may set forth your true life-giving word and rightly and duly administer your sacraments. To all your people, give your heavenly grace, and especially to those participating in this online service, may we each receive your word with meek hearts and due reverence and serve you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. We also ask you of your goodness, Lord, to comfort and sustain all who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Finally, we bless your holy name for all your servants who've died in the faith of Christ. We think of them, our brothers and sisters, those who might have been in our families, our friends, or our colleagues. Give us grace to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of your heavenly kingdom. Grant this, Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as we come to the Lord's table, we remind ourselves that we can only come because of his great love for us. Although we are completely undeserving of his love, yet in order to raise us from the darkness of death to everlasting life as his sons and daughters, our Saviour Christ humbled himself to share our life and to die for us on the cross. In remembrance of his death and as a pledge of his love, Jesus instituted this holy sacrament of communion. But we who would eat and drink of the cup of the Lord must examine ourselves and amend our lives. We must come with a penitent heart and steadfast faith. Above all, we must give thanks to God for his love towards us in the Lord Jesus Christ. So I invite all who truly and earnestly repent of sin to recommit our lives in love and generosity with our neighbours and to state our intentions to live a new life, following the commandments of God and walking in his holy and wonderful ways. Let us draw near with faith, but let us first make a humble confession of our sins. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, Judge of all people, we acknowledge with shame the sins we have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your wrath and indignation against us. We earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for all our misdoings. Have mercy on us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please you in newness of life, to the honour and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all who with hearty repentance turn to him in faith, have mercy on you and me. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear these words of assurance for all who truly turn to Christ. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." That's from Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. And so, we lift up our hearts. We give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, our Lord, our mighty Creator and God. Therefore, with angels and all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory to you, O Lord Most High." We pray, we do not presume to come to your table, Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies, We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose nature is always to have mercy. All glory to you, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption. He made there by his one offering of himself a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice, satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he'd given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and again giving you thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Well, you might like to pray in your home this prayer of spiritual communion, which is going to come up on the screen. I invite you to do that, and if you have bread and wine, to take that now. The body of Christ, keep us in eternal life. The blood of Christ, keep us in eternal life. Friends, let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For yours is the power, the glory, and the kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Father, we offer and present to you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, our bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice. And we humbly beseech you that we may be filled with your grace and heavenly benediction. And although we are unworthy, we pray that you will not weigh our merits, but rather pardon our offenses through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Father, world without end. Amen. Let's close our service by saying together the hymn of praise. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Friends, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.